So there will be two lectures today, or two parts if you want. The first one is called Introduction to Superconducting Qubits. And the goal here is to go through the basic, the basic ideas and concepts of this field. So I will explain things really from scratch. And in the second half of this part, we will also see in quite a bit of detail how one particular type of superconducting qubit works. This is the so-called phase qubit. Then in the second part, I made a selection of a couple of topics in superconducting qubits, which are, first of all, we are looking at different types of superconducting qubits, because there are so many types out there right now. The second topic will be cavity quantum electrodynamics, so interaction between artificial atoms and light. And finally, I will also say a few things about a more particular way to implement a two-qubit gate. As you know by now, superconducting qubits are represent only one of the many possible ways to implement quantum computing. So the situation is very different here of regular computing, where, as you all know, silicon-based devices are a clear winner, in particular for the heavy part of processing. With quantum computing, we are still exploring various options, because of the field is actually still quite young. So when you look at implementation in particular, I think you can say that it's about 15 years old. About 15 years old. So it will still take a while until we understand clearly the limitations and the possibilities with different technologies. And actually, there is even a good chance that a quantum processor, which hopefully we'll build one day, will contain elements of all of these different technologies. if you look broadly at the class of at the different quantum systems considered for quantum computing, you can distinguish between two classes, which are, first of all, the so-called traditional quantum systems, where you have systems such as single atoms and ions, nuclear spins, and single photons. So these systems share the feature that, first of all, they are defined really by fundamental constants in physics. And then they had been explored in the lab for a very long time before new ideas of the field of quantum computing came up. And these are just some examples of just some illustrations from a few experiments. The selection is maybe not most suitable here, but you can see, for example, a picture of a molecule here used to implement a quantum algorithm using nuclear magnetic resonance. This is from an experiment involving photons. So in those experiments, you have photon sources. Photons then are sent on beam splitters, which can be used to implement gates and so on. And finally, this is a picture from an ion trap experiment, where you can see a bunch of atoms trapped in an electrostatic trap. This is a so-called pole trap. And these ions can interact to each other through their Coulomb repulsion. As I mentioned earlier, these systems are well characterized, and they also have the advantage of long coherence times, and this is very important, are also well understood. So there are issues with coherence in some experiments, but actually the intrinsic coherence times are so good for these systems that very often limitations in coherence actually arise from experimental imperfections. But there is also a drawback here, which is that it's difficult in general to scale these systems up, because they do not naturally group together. So these are very basic entities. So for example, you can put about 10, maybe to 15 ions in a trap, but then you start to have problems, because the ions simply do not interact well with each other anymore. So now a second class of qubits is formed by artificial quantum systems. These are solid-state structures which are based either on semiconductors or superconductors. And in order to observe quantum effects in these systems, you have to go to nanoscale, where confinement effects give you energy scales at which you can control the quantum mechanical behavior. These solid-state systems have a larger flexibility in design of quantum properties, because here, as you'll see also with superconducting qubits, you rely not on fundamental constants, but on so-called mesoscopic constants. So you can actually tailor the quantum properties and obtain for example, energy level splittings, transition matrix elements, in a way which depends really on the design. Another useful feature is that the excitation energy is usually high, and for that reason, initialization is easy. So as you'll see, we initialize the state of the qubits, but simply by brute force cooling, which is very different of NMR or some atomic physics experiments where we have to use other tricks. Another advantage is the fact that there are good prospects for scalability. So it's easy to put many qubits together. You could say straightforward, of course, if you are maybe not cautious enough. But let's say it's easy enough. It's really easy to bring many of these qubits on a chip and make them interact and so on. But this is not to say that the challenges associated with quantum control of many qubits are trivial. But there is also a drawback which has to do with the coherence. And this is because when you look at the systems, their physics is quite complicated. And not everything which is related to their interaction with the environment is well understood. I will not have much on the coherence in this course. But I should maybe at least say that with superconducting qubits, actually, things have gotten so much better, in particular due to a couple of breakthroughs over the last 1 or 2 years. And the relevant number to look up here is the fact that in 1999, when the first demonstration of quantum coherent oscillations on a superconducting qubit was done, the coherence time was of the order of 1 nanosecond. And now you can actually have these qubits with coherence times of 10 microseconds or even larger. So this is an improvement of about 4 orders of magnitude over 10 years. And if you think about it in this way, it's really impressive. And this comes only through gaining more understanding on the physics of these systems. And if you look at these numbers, so the 10 or tens of microseconds coherence time, actually, at this point, superconducting qubits are already above some quantum error correction thresholds, which probably you've seen in some of the lectures in this school depend on architecture and so on. But let's say from that point of view, things look quite encouraging. So there is still not full understanding of where the coherence comes from, but we are already there in a way when we think about this challenge. So. As I mentioned earlier, so these are two pictures of solid-state qubits. I think you've done some scanning electron microscopy in the clean room, right? So now you know how these kind of pictures are obtained. So what you see here is a picture from the first experiment on a so-called charged qubit. So this was done in 1999. And this is a more recent picture from an artificial qubit built using superconductors. So what you can see here, the dark gray region is the surface of a so-called two-dimensional electron gas. So we have electrons here in a thin layer. And then these light gray regions are metallic electrodes which are used to define potentials over here which confine the electrons. So when you tune up all these potentials right, you have wells where electrons can reside. And eventually, with proper tuning, you can have only one electron in this region here. And then you can manipulate the charge degree of freedom or spin degree of freedom and so on. But I'll not say more about semiconductor-based qubits. The last thing I want to mention is that if you look at the field of superconducting qubits, or maybe I should say more generally superconducting quantum circuits, this field has grown tremendously over the last few years in particular. And now there is research going on, first of all, on quantum design issues. So we're still trying to understand what the best design approaches are to superconducting qubits. Then on characterization of the coherence, as I mentioned earlier, which is really a central part, in fact, in quantum information in general. Then people are also thinking about different ways to implement 1 and 2 qubit gates, and in the second part of the lecture today I'll have something on that. There is also a part which is not necessarily about quantum computing, which is quantum optics in the strong coupling regime. So here you can look at the interaction between a single atom and light, and with superconducting circuits you can make that interaction very strong, actually the strongest that you can make, way larger than what can be achieved with natural atoms and light. And finally, there are also interesting experiments you can do in quantum measurements. All right, so let me get started from from the basics. So this is the plan of this first part. I will start with the LC resonator, which is the simplest electromagnetic circuit, which will be used to explain how charge and currents and so on, so all these quantities which show up in electrical circuits can eventually behave quantum mechanically and have the properties we want for quantum computing. Then I will say a few things about superconductivity, in particular why the superconducting state is special, and also I'll mention a couple of properties such as the no dissipation and phase coherence, which are both essential when designing superconducting qubits. The next part will be about Josephson junctions, and I think in the lab you've already seen how Josephson junctions look like. These are really essential components of superconducting qubits. So actually, you cannot build useful qubits, you cannot build qubits without Josephson junctions. So superconductors by themselves are not sufficient. And finally, we'll take one type of qubit, the so-called phase qubit, which is chosen here because it's the simplest type of circuit, but it's also actually one of the main candidates for quantum computing with superconductors. And we'll go really through all the details concerning how the circuit is built up, then also how you make a qubit out of this electrical circuit, and then all the ingredients that you need for quantum computing, which are state initialization, state control for 1 and 2 qubits, and then state measurement. Okay, so let's start with the LC resonator. So if at this point is surprising for you, the fact that we look at this, the reason is, in fact, and I remember actually when I was about to start my PhD, so I had my interview and I visited this group working on superconducting qubits, which was a very new topic at that time, and I saw people which are known to be serious physicists drawing electrical circuits, and I was obviously a bit surprised about that, and it's not a priori, it's not obvious why this electrical circuit representation is useful, because you might think, okay, these are electrical circuits, we know that they might be used for some tasks, but why do we want to look at quantum physics with electrical circuits? So the reason is that when you look at superconducting circuits, the dynamics of these circuits actually involves electromagnetic fields and charges in metals, you deal with excitations at frequency omega, for which the wavelength when calculated for light in free space is much longer than the size of this circuit. So when you look at basic excitations, they look like excitations of the electromagnetic field and charges and magnetic flux, which is why it is really appropriate to use this electrical circuit representation to look at the basic physics. And this was not at all obvious 20 years ago. Actually, in the 80s, these were still major questions in the field of mesoscopic superconductivity. And it took, so the progress over the last 10 years was quite accelerated and largely driven by quantum computing. But it wasn't until that 1999 experiment that I mentioned that people really understood that, so both from a theoretical point of view and also in practice, that this should be indeed the case, that you can use this LC, that you can use electrical circuits to look at what is relevant for superconducting circuits. So when we take such an LC resonator, to understand how it works, we can start simply with Kirchhoff's laws. So first of all, we can write current conservation at this node here. The sum of the current for the capacitance and the inductance equals zero, so this gives us the first equation. And then you can write that the sum of the voltages around this loop is equal to zero. And next, it turns out to be convenient to define, in addition to charges and voltages, two additional variables to describe the dynamics of these circuits. So these are, first of all, the charge through a two-port circuit, which is simply the time integral over the current from minus infinity to the present time. Then you also define the flux, which, again, for a two-port circuit is defined as the time integral of the voltage. So this is, of course, obvious. This second part, these second equations appears maybe, so this is, you can think of this in analogy with Faraday's law, where if you apply a time varying magnetic flux, you obtain a voltage around the loop. But this does not necessarily refer to a loop. It refers, in fact, to just a two-terminal circuit, such as a simple capacitor or inductor. In addition to Kirchhoff's laws, you also have to use relations between flux, charge, and current or voltage for the capacitor and the inductor. And these are, as you all know, the charge is equal to the capacitance times the voltage for the capacitor, and then the current is the flux divided by the inductor for the inductance for the inductor. So now, when you combine all the equations we wrote down up to this point, you end up with this. So the time derivative of C times phi L dot is equal to minus phi L divided by L. So when you take this equation, you can see that you can write down a Lagrangian for this, which has this expression. So this is half C phi dot L squared minus half 1 divided by L phi L squared. And in fact, this equation of motion for the magnetic flux corresponding to the inductor can be obtained from the Lagrange equation equations applied to this one variable system. Did you all have analytical mechanics in your undergrad courses so far? Okay, so this is all clear for everyone. Okay. So now the reason you do that is because when you introduce analytical mechanics, so Lagrangian, Hamiltonians, and so on, this is actually the best starting point for a quantum description of this LC circuit. So to take this farther, we define the Hamiltonian, which requires the definition of a momentum. So this momentum is the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to phi L dot. And then you can write down the Hamiltonian, which is P phi L dot times phi L minus L, and this results in this function here. And if you look at the two terms here, the first one is in fact the electrostatic energy in the capacitor, and the second term is the magnetic energy in the inductor. So now once you have this in hand, you can use a well-established procedure in quantum mechanics to turn a classical system into a quantum system. And this procedure is called canonical quantization. So the first step is to take the classical Hamiltonian, so the classical Hamilton function, and turn that into a quantum operator. And the way you do that actually is by taking all the classical variables, so the magnetic flux on the inductor and then the conjugate momentum, and turn those into operators. And when you do this, you have to go from variables to operators. So you take the Poisson brackets corresponding to pairs of variables in your Hamiltonian description, and you make the result of a Poisson bracket to be equal to the commutator of those two corresponding of those two operators. And when you do that, also Planck's constant creeps in here. And when you look at the LC resonator, so again you have the Hamiltonian, which is written the same way, but now it becomes an operator, and then you have this commutation relation between the conjugate momentum to phi and phi, so their commutator is I times h bar. So when you look at these two operators, p phi and phi, these are analogous to the x, actually p and x variables in the mechanical oscillator. And the correspondence between this LC resonator and the mechanical oscillator is complete. If you look at this table here, so you have the correspondence between xp and phi and p phi, and then also between the mass and the capacitance, and then the spring constant of mechanical oscillator and the inverse of the inductance. So now the harmonic oscillator is written in many basic textbooks on quantum mechanics. If you want to look this up in more detail, 8 is an excellent reference on that. But as I said, it's a pretty common topic in introductory texts. And the results of calculating energy eigenvalues, eigenstates, and so on are summarized here. So when you look at the energy eigenstates, these are given by this relation. So we have n, an integer, plus a half times h bar omega LC, where omega LC is the resonance frequency of the LC resonator, which is given by 1 divided by square root of LC. So in this picture here, you have the harmonic potential corresponding to the oscillator. So that's half k x squared. And then plotted on top of it, you have the energy levels which form this equidistant structure separated by h bar omega LC. So with mechanical harmonic oscillators, we know that quantum mechanical behavior can be observed in certain special circumstances. And based on this complete similarity between the two systems, you might expect the same to be the case for the LC resonator. But this does not happen without you doing something about it. And in order to analyze whether quantum mechanical behavior is possible, you have to look at the interaction between the system and the environment. So one aspect of this is thermal population. So if you want to prepare a harmonic oscillator in its ground state, then you have to fulfill this condition. So you need to have KBT much larger than the energy level spacing H bar omega LC. When you take regular LC resonators at 300 kelvins, this condition is not satisfied. So one first trick we have to use here is cooling down these resonators to very low temperatures, typically of at a few tens of millikelvins. And when you do that, you see that if you take an LC resonator with a frequency of 2 gigahertz, and 2 gigahertz, so if you look just for reference, this is close to the frequency at which mobile phone works, and in these mobile phones you do have LC resonators which are used, for example, as filters. So this is a relatively standard number. It's not an LC resonator that you would build with components off the shelf. So not the kind of resonator that you would just put together by soldering a couple of components, but this kind of value can be achieved. And if you take h times nu for this 2 gigahertz number, then you end up with something which is 10 times KBT for this temperature. All right, so the second aspect of the interaction with the environment is dissipation. So if you take an LC resonator formed with components which are metals in a normal state, and if you consider this frequency range, 1 to 10 gigahertz, then the quality factors are typically 10 to 100. So in such a system, even if you create a very pure quantum state, decoherence leads to losing this state over a time scale, which is Q, the quality factor divided by omega LC. So this happens really fast when this Q is small. So here to overcome this problem, you have to use superconductivity. So if you use metals in the superconducting state, the quality factors go from typically 10 to 100 to 10,000, going even up to a million, and actually even larger than that in really special circuits. So we need to use superconductivity if we want to observe quantum effects in an LC resonator. But in addition to this, we also need another ingredient, which is nonlinearity, and this is what is provided by Josephson junctions. So when we use superconductors with Josephson junctions, we obtain a so-called anharmonic energy level structure, and this is what allows us to define two-level systems or quantum bits in these circuits. So this is just a cartoon on superconductivity. So If you look at regular metals in the normal state, you know that first of all they are characterized by finite conductivity, which means basically that you have a resistance to current flow. Also in the normal state there is no particular order in the state of the electrons that you have in the metal, and also there is no energy gap for excitation. So you can excite electrons in a metal by providing an energy which is which is extremely small if the piece of metal you look at is very large. So now, when you go to a low enough temperature, so below a so-called transition temperature, which is for aluminum, for example, is 1.2 Kelvin, the metal becomes superconducting. The first important property of this is infinite conductivity. And here, when I say infinite, I should be a bit careful because, in fact, you only have infinite conductivity if you look at currents which are at low frequency. As you go at higher and higher frequency, the conductivity is actually the conductivity becomes finite. Then a very important property which is important for superconducting qubits in particular is that you have electron order, and in particular what happens is that the electrons, actually only a fraction of them to be exact, become bundled in the so-called Cooper pair. So you have them forming you could say some electron molecules, finally, the last property is the appearance of an energy gap. So now you cannot create excitations in the superconducting metal with quasi-zero energy. You need to provide an amount of energy which is actually of the order, when you translate it to energy, is actually of the order of this transition temperature. So now when you look at this energy gap, this gap for electron hole excitations still survives in small electromagnetic fields. So if you apply electric magnetic fields, even AC fields, you still have an energy gap. For superconducting qubits, we actually look at excitations which are below this energy gap. And in order to build these excitations, you need to combine the superconductor itself with the electromagnetic fields which surround it. So now if you look at the combined system superconductor plus electromagnetic fields, you can obtain these low energy excitations, which moreover have an anharmonic spectrum when you bring in Johnston junctions. And the energy scales for these excitations are given by two energy scales which correspond to Josephson junctions, which are the Josephson energy and the charging energy. And I will introduce this to later. Of course, I can only mention the things we immediately need about superconductivity in this lecture. But the first important property, which I already mentioned, is dissipationless currents. So this property is in fact connected to the fact that there is an energy gap to excitations. One other important point is that if you look at typical superconductors, you can send currents without dissipation as long as the currents do not exceed the so-called critical current, which is of the order of mega amps per centimeter squared. And it turns out that these critical currents are much more than what you need in order to have superconducting qubits working. Another property of the superconducting state is phase coherence. So the superconducting state, you can think of it as a Bose-Einstein condensate, for example, if you are familiar with that notion. So what happens is that the Cooper pairs occupy the same quantum state, so they have bosonic character, and then you can describe variations in the wave function using a phase. Phase gradients are associated with the flow of current in a superconductor, and if you take just a bulk superconductor, the current density J depends on phase gradient, so this is where the phase gradient comes in. And in addition to this, it also depends on applied magnetic field. So you have here this minus 2E divided by H bar times A vector, where A is the vector potential of the electromagnetic field. And finally, rho is the density of Cooper pairs. So for the remainder of this lecture, I will not talk much about what you can do with magnetic fields. Actually, in the second part of the lecture, I will say a few things about the flux qubits, where the fact that you use magnetic fields is important. Okay, so now let's move to Josephson junctions. So Josephson junction is such a sandwich structure formed by two superconductors with a tunnel barrier in between. And this tunnel barrier is provided typically by an insulating layer. The main point here is that in order to see the effects we are after, you need this tunnel barrier to be very transparent, so you need it to be extremely thin, and in fact, the thickness is of the order of a few atomic monolayers. So sometimes it's actually quite surprising that it works. Transport of electrical charge between the two sides of the barrier takes place through tunneling of Cooper pairs. And this transport mechanism actually takes place without dissipation. So you have tunneling transport, which in normal metal junctions would lead to some dissipation of energy. In this case, there is no dissipation at all. And this by itself was seen as very surprising when this effect was calculated in 1962 by Josephson. And actually, at that point, it was one of the theorists who explained superconductivity who didn't believe this. So this is how this should give you an idea of how subtle this effect was seen to be. So when you look at the two superconductors, you can characterize each of them with a phase, which would be gamma 1 and gamma 2 for the left and right side, and then it's the phase difference which matters for the properties of the junction. So this is gamma 1 minus gamma 2. A Josephson junction can be described using the two Josephson relations. So the first one, also called the current phase relation, connects the current to the phase difference delta. So we have I equals AC sine of delta, where IC, the so-called critical current of the junction, is a parameter which depends on many things. So it depends on the superconductor, the barrier thickness, the barrier surface area. For some typical numbers, if you look at aluminum with a very thin barrier, as we have for the junctions we fabricate here, and if you take junction sizes from, say, between 100 times 100 nanometer square up to 1 times 1 micrometer square, then this critical current ranges between 0.1 and 10 microamperes. The second Josephson relation connects the voltage across the junction to the time derivative of the phase. The proportionality constant which comes here is the so-called flux quantum, which is H divided by 2E. Yes.
So before you continue, can you just talk a little bit about what the phase is exactly? You're saying it's an important variable in characterizing the wave function in the superconductor, but I'm not too clear what it is. Is it observable, or is it only?
Well, so actually, this is a very good question, and in fact, well, so the phase itself is not an observable, but phase gradients are observable. So if you take just a piece of bulk superconductor and you try to measure this phase, you actually realize that this is not a meaningful quantity. But phase gradients, and in a way you can, well, this makes sense because, again, if you think about the fact that this is a quantum system, so you have a whole bunch of Cooper pairs which condense in the same state, then this phase, you can think about this phase as the phase of a wave function, which is not a relevant quantity when you think about measurements, for example. But now phase gradients, again, as you have with a single particle, are important. And the case of a single particle in quantum mechanics, you know that in that case as well, if you calculate the current associated with that, you also have a term there which is proportional to the phase. And this is because you have something which looks like psi, the wave function, time the gradient of the conjugate of psi, and this is where the phase would come up. So now, from a microscopic point of view, the phase is a parameter for how the ground state of a superconductor looks like. So if you look at the ground state of a superconductor, this is a many particle state which has quite a complicated structure. And the phase is something which describes how these Cooper pairs, how states with different electrons pair are referenced to each other, as far as, again, the phase of the wave functions is concerned. So it has a here I was talking mostly about the phenomenological theory, which actually came up quite early in the history of superconductivity. So before before the microscopic theory was put together in the 50s. But this phase also has a meaning in the microscopic theory. So does this, are you satisfied with the, okay, all right. So is this clear for, so I guess I went a bit fast over this. It's actually not, it is a pretty subtle concept, in fact. And if you are to go really to the bottom of it, then there's really a lot of theory you have to go through. So if you're interested, I can provide some more references. All right, so where was I now? So now, if you take this relation here, so if you remember earlier, we defined the flux corresponding to a two-terminal electrical component as the time integral of the voltage. So now, if you do the same, starting with this relation, you end up with the flux for the Josephson junction, which is proportional to this phase delta. And this is given here. So you have delta equals 2 pi times phi divided by phi naught. So now, if you use the first Josephson relation, you obtain this equation here. So I equals IC times sine of 2 pi phi divided by phi naught. So this is when you look at the structure of this, you have a relation between the current through a component and the magnetic flux, and this is the same as you would have for a regular inductor. So for a simple inductor, the current is equal to the magnetic flux divided by the inductance. So now, if we introduce another parameter, the Josephson inductance corresponding to this Josephson junction, we can, so this is defined over here, then we can rewrite this relation in the following form. So the current is phi naught divided by 2 pi Lj times, again, sine of 2 pi phi divided by phi naught. So this only looks more complicated for now, but when you look at the limit in which the magnetic flux is much smaller than the flux quantum, then you can linearize this relation and you obtain the following. So the current is the magnetic flux divided by Lj. So now this relation looks exactly like what you have for a regular inductor, which also makes it clear why I call this quantity at this point the Josephson inductance. So now again, for typical Josephson junctions used for qubits, this Josephson inductance has this order of magnitude. So you have values between less than a tenth and up to a few nanofarads. Okay, so now when you think about charge transport through the Josephson junction, as I mentioned earlier, there is a channel which corresponds to Cooper pairs tunneling from one superconductor to the other. But there is another channel for charge transport which corresponds to accumulation of electrical charge on the two sides of this barrier. So if you measure the electrical current somewhere here, then this is due to both Cooper pairs which cross the barriers and Cooper pairs which pile up around this barrier here. So you can write the total current as Ij, where Ij is the Josephson term I mentioned earlier, and then Ic, where Ic is this is the current corresponding to this effective capacitor formed by the two superconductors and the barrier, and then you can introduce the capacitance C and the relations corresponding to a capacitor, just as we had earlier for the LC resonator. Excuse me?
What is the barrier?
You mean physically, so the barrier is commonly formed by an oxide layer. So since you need a very transparent barrier, it makes more sense that you use an oxide which is formed with the superconducting metal itself. And this is in fact the reason why you use aluminum, because aluminum forms a very thin and robust oxide layer. So as I said earlier, it's only a few monolayers thick, and the fact that it works is kind of magical in itself, in fact. So all right, so now with these equations for the Josephson junction in hand, we can proceed to describing the junction quantum mechanically. So if you look at Now, this current, which, so IG plus IC, if you simply take a Josephson junction which is not connected to anything, this current has to be equal to zero. So, so in fact, all the equations we used earlier for the LC resonator can be used now to derive an equation of motion for the magnetic flux corresponding to the Josephson junction branch. The only change you need to take care of is the fact that the current is proportional to the sine of the flux times a constant, as opposed to this kind of relation that we used earlier for a simple inductor. So now if you use Kirchhoff's laws for the current, voltage, and so on, and you simply follow the canonical quantization procedure I described earlier, you end up with a Hamiltonian for the single Josephson junction, which has this form. So you have, again, a first term, which is p phi, so where p phi is the momentum conjugated to phi. So you have p phi squared divided by 2c. And then you have a second term, which in the case of the linear resonator was phi squared divided by 2l. Now it's a bit more complicated since you have a cosine here of phi and then a constant in front, which depends on lj. So we can represent this circuit in the following way. So we have a two-branch circuit with a capacitance and the Josephson inductance, which is a nonlinear inductance. So now, actually, we went already through most important steps in obtaining qubits, and this can be understood by looking at this figure here, which is actually quite essential. I think this really pretty much sums up why superconductors with Josephson junctions are qubits. So just as I showed earlier, you have this parabola which gives you the magnetic energy for a linear LC resonator. So this is again just a plot of phi squared divided by 2L. And when you calculate the energy levels for that system, you have the black lines here. So these are, when you look at the distance between the two levels, this is h bar divided by omega LC. So you have an equidistant level structure, which is also called the harmonic for that reason. Now when we take the potential energy corresponding to a single Josephson junction, this has this expression here. So you have 1 minus cosine of something involving magnetic flux. And the plot of this is given by the blue curve in this graph. So for large excitations in this potential, you can see that the potential becomes softer and softer. So you can think of this as maybe a soft spring, so a spring for which the spring constant becomes lower and lower as you stretch it up. And you can again calculate the energy levels, and these are given by the blue lines. So what happens now is that these energy levels are systematically lower than for the case of a harmonic potential. So you have En larger than En for JJ, the Josephson, smaller for the Josephson junction than for the LC resonator. And most importantly, when you look at the distance between two consecutive energy levels, this goes down as you go up the ladder. And this is what I meant earlier by anharmonic energy level structure. So now, this is actually really essential for building qubits. And the way you can see this is as follows. So say you put the Josephson junction in its ground state. So you have this energy level here. And now you send electromagnetic radiation, which matches this energy level splitting between the ground state and the first excited state. So you have transitions taking place between these two states. And now, in principle, you could also have transitions between this state and this second excited state. But because the energy level difference doesn't match this first energy level difference, so it doesn't match the excitation frequency, you can keep the system in this Hilbert subspace formed by the ground state and the first excited state. And this is really essential if you want to build qubits. If you are to excite a regular harmonic oscillator, you actually create rather trivial quantum states. These are the so-called coherent states, and they are not really, you don't really have a handle on a harmonic oscillator to use that for quantum computing.
Now let's move to the last part, which is the phase qubit. So the phase qubit is actually simply just a junction to which you attach a bias current source. So you take the Josephson junction I showed to you earlier and you send a current through it. So I chose this qubit as an example because it is the minimal circuit for building a qubit. So for all qubits you need at least one Josephson junction. But you should take seriously in the sense that the phase qubit is actually one of the main candidates for implementing quantum computing with superconductors. So when you add this current source, the role of it is first of all to increase anharmonicity of the qubit, and I'll explain in a bit how that works. And the other reason is the fact that this current here actually also acts as a knob for the qubit. So in order to work with the qubit, you need to control the quantum state. And for the phase qubit, you do this simply by changing the value of this current in suitable ways. So now, when you look at the electrical circuit for this qubit, you proceed just as I showed earlier with the Kirchhoff's current law. So you have the sum between the currents in the Josephson channel, the capacitance equals IB. So when you put again everything together as I showed earlier, you obtain an equation of motion for the magnetic flux phi, which has the which is given by this. So and just as we did earlier for the LC resonator, you can show that when you write a Lagrangian formed by C phi dot squared divided by 2 and then a potential energy which has this expression here, then you can you obtain again the Kirchhoff's current law. So using the same procedure you derive this Hamiltonian here for the phase qubit, which contains just as I showed earlier, you have P phi squared divided by 2C, so this is the kinetic part. Then you have final squared divided by 2 pi squared J, okay, there's many constants, 1 minus cosine 2 pi phi divided by phi naught. So if you take these two terms together, this is exactly what we had for the Josephson junction, which is not connected to any circuit. But now when you add this bias current, you have a certain, which is minus IB minus IB times phi. So now this first term, well, when you look at how this potential looks like, so you have just the cosine term, which is this term here, and then you add to it the tilde term. So when you put the two together, you still have the periodicity of the cosine left, but with this tilde term, you obtain some potential wells which have a lower height and become quite shallow. And one effect of this is that the anharmonicity of the system is increased. So if you look now at the difference between this energy level splitting and this energy level splitting, it becomes quite pronounced. Now, you also it's important at this point maybe to mention some typical values for the elements which make up this circuit. So for a Josephson junction used as a qubit, you have typical critical currents which are in the 10 microamps range, then a capacitance of about 10 femtofarad. And you apply a bias current which is quite large, so typically 99% of IC. So if this bias current was IC, then the potential well would disappear completely. So you would have something like this. So there would be no well left over here. So you really have to push this current quite high. So the actual qubit is formed by
the ground state and the first excited state in this well. And sometimes, depending on how you bias the qubit so depending on the current you apply, you might have yet another state which lives in this well. So now, of course, you have to keep in mind that these states are metastable states. So in fact, they are not proper energy eigenstates of this system. The energy eigenstates are actually not bound states, but The main idea here is that you can have these states, and given a barrier which is large enough and thick enough, you can actually have these states to be pretty long lived. So it's still the lifetime of these states is not at all a major, is not at all a source of concern when you think about keeping the qubit in one of these two states. So now the energy of these two energy eigens of these two basic states E0 and U1 depend on the bias current IB, and let's assume in the following that you decide on some static bias current IB0. So now for that particular value of that bias current, you can diagonalize the Hamiltonian. So you can write down the Hamiltonian of the qubit as using this expression. So you have h bar omega 0 1. So omega 0 1 is the energy level difference between the two states times z, where z is one of the free poly matrices, which I'm sure you've seen a lot in these lectures here. So now this defines the Hamiltonian at a particular operation point, IB0. If you now change the value of the bias current, the Hamiltonian will change. And so if you add a small current on top of IB0, which is delta IB, the Hamiltonian depends on this delta IB. And you can single out the initial Hamiltonian we had, H0. And then the remainder is h of IB0 plus delta IB minus h of IB0. So at the end of the day, you can write h tilde of delta IB equals h0 minus delta IB times phi. So you see now that the difference between the unperturbed Hamiltonian and the perturbed Hamiltonian is a term which is proportional to the current you add, and which contains this operator phi corresponding to the electrical circuit you look at. Is this clear here, this part? OK. So now you have this term, minus delta IB times phi. This operator phi is actually an operator acting on the Hilbert space of the Josephson junction with its current source and so on. So you have to think about how you describe this operator in terms of the two-dimensional Hilbert space pertaining to the qubit. So what you need to do there is to calculate. Probably you've seen this in these lectures here. But if you have an operator acting on a qubit, you can decompose that as a sum over the poly matrices. So you can write it as a combination of the identity matrix x, y, and z. So you can do the same here for this operator phi, and what you obtain is that there is a contribution proportional to x and the contribution proportional to z. So the one way you can see why these two contributions come up is through the fact that when you calculate the energy eigenstates corresponding to this potential, these are you can make this real functions. So now when you calculate matrix elements for this operator phi, that has to lead to real numbers as well. And this is the fact why poly matrix doesn't come into this projection on the two basis states. Okay, so at this point you actually have all the tools you need to think about qubit initialization, manipulation, and so on. So let's start with the qubit state initialization. So what you do here is set the IB current to that particular value decided on, IB0, and then you allow for a waiting time so that the qubit relaxes to the ground state. So now, given the fact that the typical energy level splittings for the phase qubit are 10 gigahertz and you work with temperature which are, say, 25 millikelvin, so this corresponds to 0.5 gigahertz, the system goes to the ground state with a probability which is extremely high. So if you calculate this probability, this has typically many zeros. So you can prepare the ground state with 10 to the minus 4 or even higher fidelity. So this is what you do for the phase qubit. But I would like to mention here that for superconducting qubits in general, there are other methods that have been developed to prepare the ground state. If for some reason this brute force cooling is not sufficient, so one possibility to be to do this would be, for example, to take. So say your qubit works at some energy level splitting EGE naught, but is this EGE naught is larger than the temperature, but maybe not much larger. So what you can do in this case is tune up your qubit so that this energy level splitting is made much larger. So you make it much larger than the temperature. With the phase qubit, this is not really easy to do, but it can be done with other types of qubits. So at this point, you prepare the ground state with large fidelity, and the next step you take is bringing the energy levels down again. And if you do this fast enough, you remain in the ground state. So if you do this step adiabatically, you remain in the ground state. So this is relatively straightforward. But what is important here is that this can be done with superconducting qubits because by changing control knobs with superconducting qubits, you can actually change the energy level splitting over a very large range. So when you think, for example, of regular atoms, if you apply an electric field or a magnetic field, you also have energy shifts. So you have the so-called Zeeman shifts or star shifts and so on. But in those cases, you only change the energy level splitting but by a tiny amount relative to the value you start with, which is different with superconducting circuits. And then other ways to do cooling are, for example, the equivalent of optical pumping. So in this case, you have to use a third level. So say you have, again, the situation that the ground state is not prepared with an efficiency as large as you like. So you have some population here, but a bit of population here. What you can do at this point is to apply I was about to say a laser, but it's not a laser. In this case, it's a microwave signal which connects this state to that state. So you have transitions which are induced between state 0 and state 2. And then you have a relaxation channel from 2 to 0. So this means that you can force the system to go to the ground state with the proper parameters. So you can apply all these tricks if needed to cool down the state even larger. But in general, simple brute force cooling is sufficient. So you do this just by waiting. All right. So now what about quantum state control? So the fact that you have terms proportional to both x and z in the control Hamiltonian means that you can do any single qubit operation that you want. So now, have you seen this in the lecture so far? So have you looked at the rotating frame? And probably you've done that in the NMR classes, right? So the idea is quite similar here. So you take the wave function of the qubit, psi of t, in the usual Schrodinger representation, and then you can define psi tilde of t through this unitary transformation. So this unitary transformation is exponential of I h naught t divided by h bar. So what this does is simply unwind qubit evolution. So if you look so you know that if you take the wave function as time zero, that evolves in time according to this exponential minus h bar, exponential minus h naught t divided by h bar. So when you add exponential of I h naught t divided by h bar, this gives you the identity. So the role of this frame transformation you do is simply to make the qubit stationary. But now when you apply some control term, some evolution will occur. And what you have here is that in the rotating frame, you can write a Schrodinger equation for the qubit, which is given here. So you have an effective Hamiltonian, hf tilde, which depends on time, which has this expression. So what you do here is you have h naught plus delta hft sandwiched between UF dagger and UF, and then you have this this term here. And some terms drop out, and you are left with HF dagger of T equals UF dagger of T times delta H. So this is the Hamiltonian you apply in addition to the static Hamiltonian, and then times UF of T. So now using this, you can first of all do phase gates. So for phase gates, you have to look at. So you have to look at the term which is proportional to Z here. So if you calculate Z in the rotating frame, this remains Z, which means that if you keep this on for some time, you accumulate some phase in the 0 and 1 eigenstates, which is different. In general, you also have to worry about these terms, such as this one, which are proportional to X. But the key point here is that if you change the current, so delta IB adiabatically, then this X term will not lead to transitions between the energy eigenstates of the qubit. So you simply accumulate some phase, and then you can go back to the initial point, and that gives you a phase gate with an angle. And this is very important, with an angle that you can fully control by controlling the amplitude of the current and the time. Is this clear? Please ask if you have any question. I mean, this is important.
Can you just repeat what you said? I'm not sure.
About the phase gate?
Yeah.
Okay, so sure. So let me see. Is it clear up to here?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So all right. And this part is clear. It's clear too, right? Okay. So the way...
I was just confused about being able to ignore the
X term. Okay, yeah. Indeed, this is not a straightforward thing. In fact, I mean, what you do is the following. So you have... So maybe it makes... Yeah, so you start with two energy eigenstates, which in the rotating frame are in fact degenerate, right? So they correspond to the same energy. So these are 0 and 1. So now what you do is you ramp. So you have delta IB, which is normally set to 0. So you just don't add any current in top of IB naught. And then you change the current by some amount over some time tau. So what will happen in this case is that you go from it makes more sense maybe to explain this in the lab frame. So let's start with this, because otherwise I need to introduce the rotating wave approximation, and I'm going to do that later. So you start in the lab frame. So you have these two energy eigenstates. Then the addition of this bias current means that if initially you had this Hamiltonian, you are going to add now terms both in on diagonal. So you have, say, minus some alpha here. And then plus alpha. So you change the energy level splitting. In addition to this, you also have some terms off diagonal. So you have, say, a beta. So now both alpha and beta are functions of delta IB. And they go to 0, of course, and delta IB equals 0. So what happens now is that by adding some finite delta IB, you actually change the energy level splitting. And the energy level splitting gets changed both as a result of this alpha term and as a result of the beta term. So now when you look given the fact that alpha and beta are of similar order of magnitude, and they are much smaller than the difference between E1 and E0, The effect of alpha is, in fact, the major effect. So the effect of beta is a second-order effect. So first of all, you can neglect it for that reason. But it still is there. And now, normally this term would cause transitions between the two energy eigenstates. But the point here is that if you change the Hamiltonian time very slowly, then the qubit population will not change throughout this procedure. So what you do is, for some time, you keep the energy level splitting at some large value. You accumulate some phase in addition to what you would accumulate just with the unperturbed Hamiltonian. And then you put it back again. So what you have to do is calculate the additional phase over this time. And if you tune everything right, then you're OK. So you just have a phase proportional roughly to the time times alpha. So that would be the additional phase that you get in this case. Does it make sense? All right. OK, so the other component you need are rotations. And for rotations, you need to look at the availability of the X terms in the Hamiltonian. And let's say you apply some AC field now to the qubit. So you have this term which shows up in the Hamiltonian, which is proportional to delta IB. And if you apply delta IB at a frequency matching the qubit frequency, so you can calculate all the factors here, and you end up with something which looks like this. So you have A times cosine of omega 0 1 t plus phi. So you have, very important, you have an amplitude and a phase. So now when you go to the rotating frame, you can calculate the Hamiltonian in the frame. So you have now a cosine of omega 0 1 t plus phi, and then when you look at, let me see. So this comes from this term here, and then you also have terms which are proportional to both x and y, to both x and y poly matrices. And now in order to simplify things, you need to do the so-called rotating wave approximation. So if you look at this Hamiltonian, you see that it has some very fast oscillating components because you take the product of two cosines or two sines or so on. So if you drop those terms, then you are left with the following. So you have cosine of phi times x minus sine of phi times y. Okay, is this clear? At this point, this is exactly the same as what you have in NMR. So when you look at this term, that means that you can, so in the rotating frame, you have a rotation axis which can be changed anywhere in the equatorial plane of the Bloch sphere. You've seen the Bloch sphere, right? So and all that. So, okay, so this phi angle here means that you can change your rotation axis in that plane. And you can do that simply by changing the phase of the microwave field that you apply to the qubit. And actually, and this is very, very useful to point out. In NMR, you have a very friendly manipulation platform given by the fact that you can work with RF fields. And this is, when you compare this to optics, this is very convenient because you can make use of lots of technology that was developed in telecommunications and electronics over the last decades, where so now it's very easy to produce very high frequency purity microwave signals. It's very easy to control amplitude and all of this. And this is also a big advantage when you talk about superconducting qubits. This is in a way much more pleasant to work with than when you do experiments with cold atoms or ion traps, where lasers are in general more difficult to maintain, and also you have to align them. So this is something which you don't need here.
So okay, so now with this term you can, where was that? Yeah, you can implement rotations around any axis in the xy plane. And here again, and this is actually so when you look at this so what I said here is that you apply an AC a current which changes in time, so an AC current. But when you look back at the Hamiltonian, you actually see that here again, when you do that, you also have terms proportional to Z. So what does this mean now? It means that when you are in the rotating frame, you actually have some oscillations which are proportional to to the Z magnetic field, if you want, in NMR. But now, again, those do not matter. And the reason for that is the fact that the frequency of these oscillations, so when you are in the rotating frame, you have to compare the frequency omega 0 1 for those oscillations with this amplitude A. So the amplitude A, so this would be the effective field in the rotating frame. So now when you have the oscillations in a component of the effective field in the rotating frame, which are much faster than A, then again you do not generate transitions. So you have to worry about this term only when A becomes comparable to omega 0 1, so when you drive the qubit very strongly. In superconducting circuits, actually you can do that. It's not possible in NMR because the coupling factors are much weaker, but in superconducting qubits you can do that. But if you stay away from that condition, then you can forget about the zeta. So again, you see, I was maybe a bit selective here, so I just said, okay, take this, forget about that, depending on okay, what you like to do. But this is all pretty big. It can be all rigorously proven. So anyways, you can show that term is not important in this case as well, simply by frequency selection, if you want. All right. And now these are just some experimental results. So this is from an experiment done in 06 or something like this. So what you see here is a picture of the phase qubits. So that was a simple Josephson junction, and the circuit is for reasons which are rather technical, is actually not as I described it. So you don't have a current source, but rather you put the Josephson junction in a superconducting loop and you apply magnetic flux to it. But you can do just what I described earlier. So here you have an experiment in which, first of all, you prepare the qubit in its superposition of the grounded excited state using a pi over 2 pulse. Then you apply a static, it is not static, which it changes in time, but you apply a slowly varying current on top of this AC field, which changes in the rotating frame, changes the energy level splitting of the qubit. So now when you are in the rotating frame, you have oscillations in both the X and Y components of this of the pseudo-spin, and this can be detected by doing a measurement on the qubit. So you see here these oscillations in the X and Y components, and this is illustrative of what I mentioned earlier about the phase which accumulates, which is proportional to this time over here. And as you can see, all of this works. I should say here that I chosen this because it's the first experiment one of the first experiments where this was done more carefully. But in fact, well, if you look at the quality of these oscillations, this is not representative of what can be done with superconducting qubits now. So as I mentioned in the beginning of the lecture, you can actually have maybe 1,000 oscillations within the decay time. It's just that in this particular case, things are simply not that good. Okay, so to do quantum computing, you need more than single qubit gates. You also need two qubit gates, and you've probably seen this in the introductory lecture. In the introductory lectures, you need single qubit gates, and then you need two qubit gates between any two qubits, and you need at least one out of these gates here. So either the C node gate, C phase, or I swap gate. I will not describe this in detail because I'm sure you have them somewhere in the lecture notes. So now, if you want to do two qubit gates, you need something which physically connects the two qubits, so something which gives you an interaction term. So with two phase qubits, you do what is shown here. You take one phase qubit, the second phase qubit, and then you connect them with a capacitor, with a very small capacitor, which looks pretty straightforward, right? Just like the first thing you would try. So. When you do I'll go through this maybe a bit quickly, but again, if you're interested, we can talk more afterwards. So now you have a more complicated circuit. You have two bias currents. You have a few branches and so on. But when you write down Kirchhoff's laws, and it turns out that you end up with only two parameters, which are the phases across this junction and across this junction, and you have two equations which look like this. So what these equations tell you is basically that the sum of, so this bias current is equal to the sum of this current, and this current going through this coupling capacitor. So you have IC1 sine of gamma 1, then the current through the capacitor C1, and then this current going through the
through the capacitor CC, the coupling capacitor, which by the way should be CC here as well, so sorry about this. So now, starting with these two equations, you can find the Lagrangian for which those two equations result from Lagrange equations. And this Lagrangian contains, first of all, the kinetic energy part, which is simply the electrostatic energy in the system. So you know that for a system of capacitors, you can describe the electrostatic energy as as a quadratic form, which involves the, this should be dots here. So you should have gamma dot T and then gamma dot. So which are basically voltages. So you can think of this as of this expression here as V, where V would be a set of voltages, which are in this case V1 and V2 across the two junctions. So this is how you write down the system the energy of a set of metallic conductors. And these are coupled through a capacitance matrix, which does not have to be diagonal in general. In this case, the capacitance matrix has this expression. So you have the two capacitors of the junctions, C1 and C2, and then you have this coupling capacitor C showing up on the diagonal and on the off-diagonal as well. And then the potential energy is simply the sum of the two potential energies corresponding to the two qubits. So you have the cosine terms and the terms proportional to gamma. So now, starting with this, you can define a Hamiltonian operator, which is again a quadratic form. You have p gammas, where p gamma is a vector which gives the two momenta conjugate to gamma 1 and gamma 2. And then you have you have the potential energy term. So now, if you look at the structure of this kinetic energy part, you have an off-diagonal term in C minus 1. So you have P1, P2, then C minus 1, 1, 1, C minus 1, 2, 2, C minus 1, 1, 2, and C minus 1, 2, 1, and then P1, P2. So now the two systems are coupled through this through the off-diagonal term coming out of here. So you have C minus 1, 1, 2, plus C minus 1, 2, 1, times P1 times P2. So you have a coupling term which is proportional to P1 P2, and this P1 P2, just as I showed earlier for the magnetic flux phi, can be connected to operators in the which are defined in the two-dimensional Hilbert space of the qubit, and in this case, let me see.
Yes, please.
Is the kinetic energy part of the Hamiltonian?
No, wait, but that is the potential energy.
U is the potential energy.
No, so what happened here? Is it just?
Oh, sorry. No. Oh, yes. I see what you mean. This should be H. Yes.
Yeah, okay.
This should be H.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry about it. Yes. So all right. So what you have here is a coupling term of the form P1 P2, and in addition to this, you also have a small change in the capacitance, which corresponds to each junction. So when you take the inverse of this matrix, you have something which looks like 1 over C1 and 1 over C2, but it's not quite that. So there is a small change in the effective mass, if you want, for each of the two nonlinear oscillators. But that's something which again is not terribly important, because you can always compensate for it properly. So now this P1 P2 term can be written in terms of two qubit operators as sigma y1 times sigma y2. When you go again to the rotating frame, so the same rotating frame that I showed earlier for one qubit, but now applied to two qubits, so you have to apply an unitary which contains you have a u frame dagger of t operator, which is exponential minus h, sorry, plus h1. T plus H2T divided by H bar. So when you apply this operator and you calculate then this interaction Hamiltonian, the rotating frame, you end up with an effective Hamiltonian which looks like this. So you have a term which takes the 1-0 state, so the state with the first qubit excited, and gives you the 0-1 state, so the state with the second qubit excited instead of the first. So this basically swaps the excitation from one qubit to the other. This second term does simply the opposite. So in addition to this, you also have again some fast oscillating terms that you can forget about based on the same argument that I mentioned earlier for single qubits. So now if you take this effective Hamiltonian and you look at So you take this effective Hamiltonian and say you prepare the state 1-0 of the system. So these states 1-0 and 0-1 are now 1-0 and 0-1 are not energy eigenstates of the system. The proper energy eigenstates are 1-0 plus 0-1 and then 1-0 minus 0-1. So these two states evolve with different phase factors, and the evolution of the system can be written like this. So you have a 1-0 and a 0-1 term, which oscillates sinusoidally in time, with a frequency which is the strength of this interaction term here, S. So if you stop this at the right time, and the right time is when what you have here is pi divided by 2, then the unitary evolution that you operate has this form here. So you have 1 at the extremes and then this i's here. So this gives you the i swap operator. So, and now based on this, you can construct any circuit for a many qubit system. All right, and this is, maybe I will not go through this in detail. So this is again from an experiment that done at UCSB where you take two qubits, you couple them through a capacitor. Again, there's a couple of experimental details you have to worry about here, but the result is that you can implement this swap operator. So what you do in this case is you take the two qubits and say initially they are not resonant to each other, so you have different energy level splittings. So you then change, you then bring this level to be high up so that you have the two qubits in resonance. And at that point, you start to have transitions between 0-1 and 1-0 taking place. So, and this is what is shown here in these figures where the population for the different states, so for example, so you start in, you start in 0-1 at this point here, and you see that over time 0-1 oscillates in time out of phase with 1-0. So again, this is from one of the first experiments. As you can see, you have loss of decay due to decoherence, but I wanted to take the simpler. So now methods become more and more sophisticated. But, all right, so the last ingredient you need is quantum measurement. And for the phase qubit, this is particularly simple and effective. So what you do is you start with your qubit at IB0. So this is a biasing condition for which you have two. Let me see. I think I swapped some colors here. It's a bit strange. So okay, but the idea is so IB0. This is you have the at IB0 you have the potential energy given by the black curve. So we have two states in the well. I meant for those to be both blue, I think. So anyway, so you have this state and this state. So now both these states are significantly below the barrier, so that no quantum tunneling takes place in either instance. Okay. Then to do the readout, you increase the bias current, so you have a potential well which is even more shallow. And here again, you increase the bias current very slowly, so the procedure is adiabatic, so you conserve the population of the qubit in the two energy eigenstates. And what will happen now is that the ground state is still well below the barrier, but the excited state is very close to the top of the barrier, so you can have tunneling with a very large probability at this point. So now you have tunneling, which is dependent on the state of the qubit. So you have nearly zero probability for this state to tunnel out, and nearly one probability for this state to tunnel out. And this provides a way to measure the state of the qubit. And these are some pictures from experiments. So what you have here is the probability for tunneling for the qubit in the zero state and then in the one state. And this is plotted as a function of the value of the bias current. So you have bias current on this axis. So you see for the qubit in the zero state, you have no tunneling taking place for a while until you push this bias current at a value which is so large that the state zero also becomes very close, or also comes very close to the top of the barrier. For state one, the threshold for tunneling occurs much earlier. So here you have a useful window of bias current values for which there is a large difference in the tunneling probability. So ideally, this should be one. And actually, in more recent experiments, it is well over 95% or so. Please.
What is the effect of the existence of the tube state in part A? Like the fact that there is a tube state trapped in the well, as well as the zero.
Well, yeah. So, but I think in practice, actually, you can this state will disappear if you increase the value of the bias current to be large enough. Then, in addition to this, you can also play other tricks. For example, what you can do is use a microwave pulse to take the one state to the two state, which and that can be done with probability nearly one, and then you have tunneling with a probability which is even higher. So you can also use that actually to implement the readout fidelity. Well, in practice, actually, the conditions are such that often you want to have state 0, 1, and 2 in the well. Because when you have that, it means that both 0 and 1 have very small probability to tunnel out during qubit manipulation. And then you can use this state 2 for readout. So there's different tricks you can play here using this. So for the phase qubit, we use this tunneling-based readout because you have a metastable condition already in the way you bias the qubit. It's very effective. But there is a drawback to it, namely the fact that the qubit ends up in some undefined state. So you don't have, for one with 50% probability on average, the qubit gets out of where you like to have it. So you need to reset your qubit and the measurement apparatus and so on. And this may take a relatively long time. You can also probe the quantum state of a qubit in more gentle ways, and that also depends at that point on the type of superconducting qubit that you use. So you have many ways to read out the state of the qubits, and in the second part of the lectures we will look at a way which is based on circuit quantum electrodynamics, which has the feature that is quite generic, so actually it can be applied to any type of qubit as soon as you can create the proper interaction term between the qubit and one superconducting resonator. Okay, so I think this is it for the first part. So are there any other questions?
Yeah, how does the stuff scale beyond 2 qubits?
So when you want to go beyond 2 qubits, things of course become very very complicated, because you need to think. So actually, you have lots of possibilities, but then you have to think about what they imply in practice. So one way to couple many qubits would be simply to take this idea, and so basically you take yet another qubit, you couple that to the second qubit through a capacitor and so on and so forth. So this can be done, and it's one possibility. But in practice it leads to complications, because since you have this coupling which is permanently turned on between all the qubits, then you have some energy levels. The energy level splitting of one qubit might depend on the state of the other qubit. So you have some complications coming up there. So then one possibility would be to replace this coupling element with a tunable coupler. So, again, depending on the type of qubit we want to use and so on, you can build small superconducting circuits which act as couplers that can be tuned using, again, some sort of electromagnetic signal. So that's one possibility to do this. Then another way to couple qubits is using a so-called quantum bus. So you have an element which couples all qubits together. But again, it's a static kind of coupler. So this is a major question in the field, actually. And my personal opinion is that you need tunable couplers if you want to have a very clean way to scale a system up. And this is also, I think it's useful to think of the analogy with regular computing, where the reason why things worked was the fact that you could characterize each element individually and then put them together. And I think here, again, the approach of tunable couplers has the advantage that you can focus on optimizing different elements individually and then scale the system up. But things are also more complicated than in classical computing, because in general you need to worry about this is obviously more challenging than building a system with a few transistors. So probably at the end you need to optimize also your architecture based on what you want to do with your quantum computer. So it's very unlikely that we will have a general use quantum computer. I think it will be something optimized for a given algorithm. And then you need to think back about your architecture. So, yeah. So the second part is what I call selected topics in superconducting qubits. I chosen a few topics which you may find interesting. Also, depending on time, I may have to go a bit quickly over this, but this shouldn't be, again, it shouldn't be, I hope, a big issue. You can always ask me questions afterwards if you're interested in this topic. The first subject I want to talk about is different types of superconducting qubits. So you can build qubits in many different ways, and I think it's useful at least to have some idea about why you look at those different ways, and also in particular how different qubits are different of each other. The second part will be circuit quantum electrodynamics. So this is again a very large field of this field of superconducting quantum circuits, in which you look at the interaction between these qubits seen as artificial atoms and light. It's interesting both because it provides a mean to do quantum computing, but also because from a fundamental point of view, it allows one to study phenomena in quantum optics at scales which go beyond what is possible with regular atoms and light. And the final part of this lecture will be on one method which is a bit more peculiar to do two-qubit gates in a system of a couple qubits. All right, so at the beginning, I would like to give you a bit of a different picture on Josephson junctions, which I hope will be also useful to clarify some of the questions which came up about why you have a phase and all of these issues. So what I'm going to go over here is not yet the microscopic theory of superconductivity or of the Josephson effect. This treatment of Josephson junction is due, in fact, to Pierre-Gilles d'Eugène, who was known for explaining complicated things in a simple manner. So I'm just going to use this to explain, hopefully in a bit of a more clear way, what the phase is. So the idea is, again, that you start with the Josephson junction you have Cooper pairs in the different superconductors, and say in equilibrium you have N1 Cooper pairs in this superconductor and N2 in this other one. And then you consider states in which a number N, lowercase n, of Cooper pairs crossed from one side to the other. So if you consider at the beginning that the barrier is very thick, so the two superconductors do not really feel each other, then when you move Cooper pairs from one side to the other, there is some change in the energy because you have some electrostatic energy which builds on the two superconductors. But you can forget about that to a first approximation, in particular if this number n is not too large. And also, in fact, if the uh, if the two superconductors are identical, in fact, moving n Cooper pairs in or out leads to the same effective energy because this is quadratic, so it goes as the square of lowercase n. So you can consider this state to be nearly degenerate, but then you say you switch on the coupling between the two superconductors, so you make this barrier thinner and thinner. It can be shown, starting with a microscopic theory of superconductivity, that in this case you can describe the system with this Hamiltonian here, which contains a constant Ej, which is the Josson energy, and then you have terms which give you quantum amplitudes to go from a state with n Cooper pairs to a state with n plus 1 Cooper pairs. So basically you go from a state of the system with n Cooper pairs having crossed the barrier to a state with n plus 1 Cooper pairs having crossed the barrier. So one more Cooper pair goes on this side. And then you have the complementary term which gives you a term such that one Cooper pair goes back. So now it's interesting to think of this in analogy with the problem in solid state, namely the tight binding model of a solid. Actually, at this point, have you seen the tight binding model in solid state? Have you taken? Because then it might be of less use maybe explaining this in this way. But you've seen it well. So it's so the idea here is the following. You have a number of so-called lattice sites. So this is the one that you can think of this as being a one-dimensional crystal with the blue dots being the lattice sites. So now if you take an electron, the electron can be present at some site, but then it can also tunnel to neighboring sites. And you have a finite tunneling amplitude to go from one site to its neighbors. So when you look at solving the problem of energy eigenstates for the electron in the crystal, you end up with the following solution here. So this is what gives you a so-called band structure for a crystal. So you have the energy eigenstates are parameterized by this parameter gamma, and these energies depend on gamma in the following way. So they are equal to minus Ej times cosine of gamma. So this is a plot of the energy of single particle states, so single electron energies in this crystal as a function of actually there should be gamma here. So now gamma is a parameter which describes the energy eigenstates. And actually, the different energy eigenstates are superpositions of states with different n numbers. So you have superpositions of equal amplitude with Cooper pairs crossing the barrier on either side. The only difference are these phase factors here in front of the different n states with a coefficient which is exponential to power I gamma n. Okay, so this shows you how you take this one-dimensional solid and you can derive an energy band and energy proper energy eigenstates. And now you can map this problem of a one-dimensional crystal with the nearest neighbor coupling to this problem of the Josephson junction. So what you there is complete similarity. The energy eigenstates look the same, and the next step is to use two results from solid state theory, which are summarized here. So the idea is that in a crystal, you can characterize one electron by its position x, and then the so-called crystal momentum k. So the crystal momentum is not quite momentum; it's something. It's a number. It's a number which corresponds to the energy, but it really is a result of the translation symmetry of the crystal. So think of it as another quantum number for now.
So is it just the compact conjugate, like just the conjugate quantity of the position?
No, it's not the complex quantity of the position. In fact, so the momentum is the quantity which is the complex of the position. But the crystal momentum is another. It's also called quasi momentum in some cases. So it is a good quantum number for the energy. But now you have to think about the fact that so if you take a particle without in zero or constant potential, then the momentum is a good quantum number, right? Because you can write the energy operator as p squared divided by 2m. So momentum is conserved. In this case, you do not have a potential which is constant in space. You have some variation of this potential because you have the different lattice sites. Mm-hmm. And now the good quantum number for that turns out to be this crystal momentum.
So it commutes with Hamiltonian?
Yes, yeah, yeah. So it's a constant of the yeah, it's a constant of motion for the crystal. So if you create a wave packet for a single particle, which is concentrated around position x and crystal momentum k, so again, this cannot be completely defined because they are quantum mechanical operator, but they can have a relatively low spread, then you have these following two results. So over time, the expectation value of x changes, and that change is proportional to the derivative of the energy with respect to the k vector with the 1 over h bar in front. Then k, the average value of the crystal momentum changes as well, and it only changes when you apply a force to the electrons. So that corresponds to tilting you don't tilt the crystal. What you do is, for example, when you apply an electric field, you have to think that you superimpose on the different atomic potential, you impose a constant, you impose a tilt term, and so then the electrons would like to move in that direction. So this describes the time variation of the momentum k. So you have this proportional to the force. So so probably you haven't seen this before. I guess you'll see it at some point, so it will at least be useful if you remember it at that point and if you think about Josephson junctions again. So, but the idea here is that we take this problem of this one-dimensional crystal and we can map things out and obtain the two Josephson equations. So first of all, if you think of charge transport, that corresponds to changing the number of Cooper pairs, n. So you have a number of Cooper pairs which cross on the other side. So the current is 2e, the charge of a Cooper pair, times n dot. And n dot is analogous to x dot here. So this current has to be proportional to the derivative of the energy with respect to gamma. And this relation here is a cosine. So when you take the derivative, you have a sine. So this provides a derivation of the first Josephson equation. For the second Josephson equation, we have to realize that applying a potential between the two sides of the barrier, so if you apply a voltage between side and this side, it means that state with different numbers n of lowercase n of Cooper pairs will have different energy, because if you move a Cooper pair from a high potential region to a low potential region, you pick up some energy. So now you can think of this energy as being the being as corresponding to a difference between the potential of different lattice sites, and this is exactly what you do here when you apply an electric field in the crystal. So now the force corresponds to 2e times v, and then this 2e times v quantity can be related to h bar gamma, where gamma is the analogous of crystal momentum, so the derivative of this with respect to dt. So now, this may not be completely transparent, what this does here, and I think this is very important, it provides a more physical picture of what this phase is in a Josephson junction. So you can connect it to something that you can maybe grasp a bit better, which is the number of Cooper pairs on the two sides of the barrier. So now this phase gamma is simply a parameter for the energy eigenstates of the Josephson junction, and you can write those energy eigenstates in terms of a linear combination of different n states. Okay. And this next step here is to take so gamma is a quantum variable. It's not a classical quantity, but you can derive some equations of motion in the classical limit. So in the limit where you can form some proper wave packets and so on. And this is what you obtain when you look at these two equations here. All right. So it's just what you write down for a position for a particle moving in a field. So you know that the wave packet spreads over time. But if you look at short time scales when this didn't happen, then you still have a pretty well-defined wave packet. And in that case, the variation of gamma is and n is given by these classical equations of motion. Okay, so this I wouldn't have time now to go through this, but I hope at least it gives a better physical picture to what the phase is when you talk about the Josephson junction. So that was my goal with this. And if you're interested in the derivation of these results, you can look up some standard solid-state physics textbooks. So for example, Ashcroft and Marmin. All right, so now you have the second Josephson relation. So 2eV is the time derivative of h bar gamma. And then through what I showed you earlier, you can you can connect the voltage to the time derivative of a flux, of a branch flux, and actually this is just in this way you can just obtain that relation we looked at earlier between the current and the critical, the current and the flux corresponding to this branch, and with you obtain this parameter, which is LJ, the Josephson inductance, which is phi naught divided by 2 pi AC. I think this is basically, I'm just repeating what I've done in the last lecture, so I'm gonna not spend lots of time on this. And then, okay, and then comes this other effect. So when you start, when you look at Cooper pairs going from one side of the barrier to the other, actually it does cost some energy to do that, because you build, so these Cooper pairs would still like to stay around the barrier, and that leads to an energy which is like the electrostatic energy you have for a parallel plane capacitor. So that energy is Q squared divided by 2C, where C is the capacitance corresponding to this junction. And Q, the total charge, is 2E, the charge of a Cooper pair, times N. So you have this factor coming in front, which is 2E squared divided by 2C, with C the capacitance. So this brings in another energy square, another energy scale, which is 2E squared divided by 2C. And this is called the charging energy. Okay, so this effect will make these initial eigenstates we started with non-degenerate. So you have to you really have to consider this, which is not in contradiction with what I talked about earlier, because the idea here is that you can diagonalize the Hamiltonian only with these quantum tunneling terms, and then bring in this charging energy and calculate its effect as an additional operator onto the different energy eigenstates we calculated earlier. And then, so at the end, it's useful to look at, and this is again what I derived in the last lecture, but I have this table here which should make things a bit more clear and systematic. So the idea is, if you take a single Josephson junction, you have two quantum operators, the phase gamma and the number of Cooper pairs n. They are conjugate variables, so their commutator is I. And you can write the Hamiltonian this way. So you have EC times n squared plus EJ1 minus cosine of gamma. So now this form is actually more useful in many instances, because you have both n and gamma are a-dimensional, and EC and EJ give in this case some proper energy scales, which will allow us to think about how, for example, this n square or the gamma square would be more important or less important in one case or another, depending on the parameters of the circuit. So you can put everything in this table, where for the Josephson junction we have the phase and the charge degree of freedom. Then you have two fundamental constants. So you have the flux quantum and the charge of a Cooper pair. And then what allows you to build an artificial atom is the fact that you for superconducting circuits you also have mesoscopic constants. So you have the critical current and the capacitance, and then you have these two associated energy scales, so EJ and EC, the Josephson and the charging energy. So by changing these parameters, you actually change the parameters of your artificial atoms. And just for some relevant scales, so you see that typically the EJs and ECs are in the gigahertz range, but they can spread over a very large interval. So at this point, there are actually many types of qubits out there. So you can think about putting together something like a Mendeleev table of superconducting artificial atoms. But this is, in fact, not to be taken very seriously, because there is no strict, let's say you very often have qubits which may behave very differently, even though they have the same type of electrical circuit. And this is just a matter of the different parameters leading to different dynamics. And also, in practice, when you make these qubits, actually they always come out a bit different of what you wanted, and a bit different in between them. It's just an effect of spreading parameters. So if you are to make a table, you should actually include all of them. But now what I would like to do is go through how you describe the phase, the charge, and the flux qubits, which are the main types of qubits that are being looked at now. And also, historically, they are quite important, actually, in clarifying some concepts in this field. So let's start with the phase qubit. You've seen it in the previous lecture, so I'll not spend much time on it. The one point that I would like to make clear here is the fact that, as I mentioned earlier, having these constants EC and EJ allows you to express this Hamiltonian in this compact form. And And for the phase qubit, you are in the situation where EJ is way larger than EC, so typically 1,000 or so. So now if you think about the energy eigenstates of this system, you have the situation that EJ is a large number. So in fact, okay, maybe it's useful to write this down in the following way. So think about EC. So the N operator is 1 over I, the time derivative with respect to gamma. Sorry, the derivative of respect with respect to gamma. So when you when you look at this at the Hamiltonian for the single Josephson junction, you have a competition between these two terms. So you have first of all a term which, if important, would like to, so for the ground state, you like to have the fluctuations in this variable gamma as small as possible, right? So you like to have eigenstates where gamma is very confined. But then, if this term was important, then you would actually like to have eigenstates for which the time derivative of for which the derivative with respect to gamma of the energy eigenstates would be confined. This would be eigenstates for which there is no much variation with respect to gamma. So they would like to spread out in gamma space. So you have a competition between these two factors when you think about the energy scale. So now for the phase qubit, you are in the limit where EJ is much larger than EC, which means that in order to minimize the energy, you would like to make the fluctuations in this term extremely small. So that means that the spread in delta gamma in the ground state is way smaller than 1. You gain more by making fluctuations in gamma small than by making the eigenstates not depend on gamma too much. So in that sense, you can say that for the phase qubit, the phase is a good quantum number. So the phase fluctuations around this equilibrium value here are pretty small. And this is the reason why you call this a phase qubit. I mentioned readout earlier, so I'm going to skip this. Then let's look at another type of qubit, the charge qubit. So this is shown in this circuit here. So you have again a Josephson junction. This is this the theta and the LJ put together. And then you apply a voltage to the system through a gate capacitor. So now, using the same rules as I showed earlier, you can quantize the system. So you obtain a Hamiltonian, which is again EC times N, but N now with an offset, which is proportional to the voltage you apply through this source here. And then you have minus EJ cosine of gamma. So in fact, it looks very, very similar. But now, at least initially, when people started thinking about this, there was a tendency to actually look at this regime where EC is much, much larger than EJ. So if you look at this first term here, so you plot this term as a function of this quantity, in fact. Okay? So the result of this plot should be parabola. So if you take n, if you make this n equal 0, then you obtain a parabola which is centered at 0. Then if you make n equal 1, you obtain another parabola which is centered at 1. Okay? And so on and so forth. So now if you are around this region here, you see that at some point these two parabolas will cross. So you have states with 0 and 1 Cooper pairs on this island here. They are degenerating energy. But this is only up to the moment when you consider this coupling term. So this coupling term will lead to a repulsion between 0 and 1. And actually, the energy eigenstates of the system become 0 plus 1 and 0 minus 1. Does this make sense? So the reason why this is called the charge qubit is the fact that it's only a very small number of charge states which enter the description. And if you are around such a point here, then it's only charge states 0 and 1 which combine to give superpositions that are energy eigenstates of the system. Since these states have different values of the charge, they can be read out simply by measuring the charge on this island here using some suitable means. But I will not go through this right now. So I was skipping another detail here, which is that, well, when you, so actually the proper way to write this down is like this. So you will write this down, in fact, in the following way. So this is an exact relation. So if you sandwich n between exponential of I gamma and exponential of, sorry, minus I gamma, this is equal to n minus 1. And this can be proven if you simply look at applying this onto states gamma. So because the states with gamma, they have simple description both in terms of phase and so on. So, this is not a commutation relation, but you can show, and I don't know whether any of you has ever looked at the relation between phase and the photon numbers for a mode of the electromagnetic radiation. So there you have a similar problem coming up. So there is a relation between quantum fluctuations of number of photons and quantum fluctuations in phase. They do not result strictly from a commutation relation, but in fact you can show that you can reduce this to a commutation relation as long as you deal with the states which are well confined in phase. That's something. So I think for that I probably to take some time now to go through that. So the idea is that here this is a commutation relation, but you should only take it seriously in the limit where the fluctuations of gamma, basically in the limit where gamma is not spread everywhere. And it's a similar, it's actually exactly the same problem as you have with the mode of the electromagnetic radiation.
I'm
skipping some stuff, but I'm happy to talk to you more about this, afterwards. So here I put an EJ cosine of gamma, but actually you should think about that term as being simply the Hamiltonian, the tunneling Hamiltonian I wrote earlier. So just the term which is n plus 1 n plus, you know, the complex, so the, yeah, the Hermitian conjugate of this. So in fact, when you take this term here, it couples states with charge 0 and 1 so 0 and 1 are degenerate to start with. But then when you take this term, this couples these two states. So you end up with this. So you have 0 plus 1 as a ground state and 0 minus 1 as an excited state. Okay? Does this make sense? So actually, maybe I should have written this term here simply as the term I showed earlier here, this tunneling. This tunneling Hamiltonian term, and then you can see why this level repulsion between states with different charges comes up. Okay, so here's basically, and again, this is something I skipped here. So when gamma is not too spread out, then you can simply take the second order approximation here, which gives you a gamma square. So this is why I wrote here a gamma square. Okay. All right. So this is the charge qubit, and then another example of a qubit is the flux qubit. So here things become a bit more complicated because you have more Josephson junctions, but the complication actually comes from the fact that you have a closed superconducting ring. So at this point, you can use the same recipe as before for calculating the Lagrangian and Hamiltonian, but you have to include specifically a constraint between the phases of the Josephson junctions in the loop. So when you look at this system here, you have phases gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3 across the three Josephson junctions. And now there will be some magnetic field that you apply to this loop externally, and these three phases can be related through the following conditions. So their sum has to be equal to has to be equal to minus 2 pi F, where F is the magnetic flux you apply in this ring divided by the flux quantum. So you can think of this as being the single valuedness condition for the phase, because as I said earlier, this is a proper quantum state, and when you go around the loop, the phase has to come back onto itself. But in addition, you have this magnetic field term, which gives you some contribution, which has to be included as well. So the proper way to write this would be minus 2 pi f plus 2 pi n, where n, okay, n is not the n there, maybe let's make it m. M is an integer, okay? So now when you have systems with closed loops, you have to worry about the magnetic field. And this means that, well, again, you can write down a Hamiltonian. The kinetic part is simply, so it depends on the n operator. So n is a vector which contains two operators, n1 and n2. And then you have this potential energy term. So you have cosine of gamma 1, cosine of gamma 2. These are Johnson energies. And then this is the Johnson energy of the surjunction, where instead of writing gamma 3, you write gamma 1 plus gamma 2 plus 2 pi f from this relation. Okay? So now you have a Hamiltonian in which you have, again, the same kinds of degree of freedom, so the gamma and the n. But then this depends specifically on this magnetic frustration. And if you take this magnetic frustration to be 1/2, then you can plot this potential energy. So you have this diagram shown here. And the basic idea is that you have some potential minima, such as this one or this one. And if you look at this potential minima correspond, in fact, to gamma 1 equal gamma 2. So now, and also this gamma 1 and gamma 2, they have, the minimum value corresponds to values which are, corresponds to something which is neither 0 or pi, so it's something in between, which means that the sign of gamma 1 and gamma 2 is non-vanishing. So you have IC1 sine of gamma 1 equals IC2 sine of gamma 2. So now you look at this system, this states actually correspond to a current circulating in this ring. Okay, because the expectation values of these operators, which correspond to the current through the junctions, give you a finite number. And you also have the same current through the different junctions. So this is for one energy eigenstate. And then for the other energy eigenstate, you have the gamma 1 and gamma 2 actually being the negatives of these two values, which means that the current is negative. So in fact, the two states of the qubit are states with the current going either clockwise or anti-clockwise around this loop. And now, in addition to this effect, which simply depends on the potential energy, you have to consider also tunneling between these two wells, which means that these states with different currents will be coupled. And now the proper energy eigenstates, just as I shown earlier here for the Cooper pair box, become this superposition and then the superposition with the minus. So in this condition where the applied frustration is 1/2, the two energy eigenstates are states in which the current flows at the same time in one direction and in the other direction, and you have a phase factor between those two. Now, when you are in the limit where f is different of 1/2, the energy eigenstates are in fact, so this would be GE, the energy eigenstates are in fact the two circulating current states. All right. Is this?
Could you explain this diagram here? I'm sorry.
All right. Okay. So this is simply a plot of this potential energy. All right. Where the variables are gamma 1 and gamma 2. Actually, I shouldn't have made those operators. Okay, just forget about the hats. I mean, you just have two variables and you plot the potential. And you have two minima. So you have this minimum here and this minimum here. So those two minima, so you have gamma 1 equals gamma 2. So in minimum A, say, you have gamma 1 equals gamma 2 equals some gamma star value. And for the second minimum, you have gamma 1 equals gamma 2 equals some minus gamma star. All right? So now when you calculate the expectation value of the current, which is provided by simply taking this operator, IC1 times sine of gamma 1, it turns out that for all the junctions in the loop, you have the same value of the current, when you look at this state. And when you look at the second state, you have, again, the same value of the current for all the junctions, but being the negative of that first value. So these two states are states with circulating current going either one direction or in the other direction in the loop. About these flux states coexisting at the same time, so the electrons going one way or the other way, this was actually seen as one of the most intriguing things about superconducting circuits in the 80s. And there is a PRL paper written by a Nobel Prize winner which has the title Quantum Mechanics versus Macroscopic Realism. Is the flux there when nobody looks? So you can check that one out. It's interesting. All right. So the second topic. Actually, I'm running like really badly out of time. So I think what I'll do is I'll go relatively quickly over this second topic, which is circuit quantum electrodynamics, and completely leave out the last one, which I think is fine because you can. Well, if you're interested, you can ask me about it. So the idea with circuit quantum electrodynamics is that you look at basic interaction processes between atoms and light. And as you know, you have either spontaneous emission or absorption or stimulated emission of light by atoms. But you can look you can think of the following configuration. So you take a one-dimensional waveguide for light. So now think of these three brown bands as being a guiding structure for light. So light can propagate along this direction or backwards without any disturbance, let's say. So this is simply a guiding structure. Now, the second thing you bring in are these discontinuity points here, which act as mirrors. So the light would actually bounce off these mirrors with the unity reflection coefficient. And now you consider this situation in which you take an atom in an excited state, so this is shown here. This atom can emit a photon, and by the symmetry of the problem, the photon can go both ways. It meets these mirrors, it gets reflected, and then when it gets back where the atom was in the middle, the two photons interfere with each other. And this interference can be either constructive or destructive. So when you have destructive interference, this means that the sum of quantum mechanical amplitudes is vanishing, which means that the atom actually has a tendency to live longer than in free space. So you have inhibited emission, which also comes under the name of Purcell effect. When you have constructive interference, which occurs when the length of where the distance between the two mirrors L is this combination of C and the atomic frequency mu A, which is the same as saying that the atomic frequency is the resonance frequency of this resonator formed by the two mirrors. So I don't know if you are familiar with Fabry-Perot resonators, for example. So you can think of this as being a resonating structure where standing waves can live. So when you are in that situation, then what will happen is that the atom will emit a photon, and then it reabsorbs it, and then it re-emits it, and so on and so forth. So there is actually a fully coherent quantum mechanical process which consists of regular emission and absorption cycles. So you have a situation such as illustrated here, where you have this energy diagram, you have energy eigenstates of the atom G and E, and then energy eigenstates of the resonator. So in the resonator you have photons, so these are bosons, so you have energy eigenstates 0, 1, and 2, and so on. So when you start with this initial state, E0, so one excitation in the atom, there is a fully coherent cycle which brings this state to G1. So now the excitation moves to the atom, and then it moves back, and so on and so forth. And for superconducting qubits, this was shown experimentally first in this paper. So this has been a major direction of research in quantum optics, because this is actually the most fundamental process you can imagine, is the interaction between one atom and one photon. And the holy grail of that field was reaching the strong coupling regime, where G is much larger than the atom and the cavity decay rate. So you want to make this process really coherent. So you want to make it happen for much longer than the decay rates. And in these review papers, if you're interested, there are two different approaches to this based on either excitations from the ground states or excitations from an excited state of alkali atoms. So now with superconducting circuits, we look at similar phenomena, but there are some differences here. And the first one is that the domain of frequencies we explore is very different. So for light in the visible range, you have frequencies of typically 10 to the 14 hertz, whereas here we deal more with gigahertz frequencies. Then with microwaves, it's also easier to shape the modes of the radiation. So to create structures where the electromagnetic field can be very confined. And one example is this one-dimensional waveguide that I showed earlier. You actually have something in an optical fiber, but the fiber itself is not very easy to be brought up in interaction with a single atom. Then another advantage is that there's no need for atomic state preparation because the system is in the ground, the atom is in the ground state to start with. And then also in general you have more flexibility because you can design circuits and so on. So the first step when you look at the quantum mechanics of light interaction interacting with an atom is to look for a formal description of light. And if you take a one-dimensional electromagnetic resonator, you know that at a fundamental level this is described by Maxwell's equations. But there is a fundamental description in terms of circuits which looks like this. So you can take an infinite network and inductors and capacitors. So now, again, you might ask, is this okay? And actually you can prove very rigorously that for transverse electromagnetic modes of the radiation propagating in a one-dimensional structure, you can make a full correspondence between this model and wave propagation. So this can be done. This can be made completely rigorously. And now you have this. You basically write. So maybe I'm going to go over this a bit quickly. I think the notes are okay for this. If you want to look into the details later, but you have this. You use Kirchhoff's laws and you derive a set of differential equations which connect the time derivative of the voltage to the space derivative of the voltage to the time derivative of the current and the other way around, the space derivative of the current to the time derivative of the voltage. The constants which come up here are L tilde and C tilde, which are the capacitance and inductance shown here per unit length of the transmission line, because both of these quantities, they scale up with the length of the transmission line. Okay, so these equations are just obtained by taking this to the limit of small delta z. And they are called telegrapher equations. So now these are fields, so they vary both in space and in time. You can write this as a sum over harmonics in space, so cosine of kz, sine of kz, with some time-dependent coefficients, a and b. And when you take the equations I showed earlier and you plug these expressions in, you obtain a set of equations for all these coefficients here of the cosine and sine terms. These are linear equations, just as Maxwell equations are, again. Then the next step is to take this transmission line and make it finite. So you break it at this end somewhere there, and that means that there will be no current at those ends. So you can say that the current at two specific values of position, which are 0 and L, is made to be equal to 0. So we impose this boundary condition. And then from that boundary condition, you obtain a relation for the k. So now k, the wave vector, acquires a discrete set of values which are proportional to an integer n times pi divided by the length L of the resonator. And also you have a reduced number of these coefficients, the a's and the b's. And at the end of the day, you end up with these two equations, which one for each k. And again, through some suitable manipulation, you can show that those equations can be related to a Hamiltonian operator, which is given here. So this Hamiltonian is proportional to q tilde k and phi tilde k, where this q and phi are charge and flux-like variables. So now there is one of these variables per each allowed value of k, where the allowed values of k are shown in this. So actually, okay, this condition you can say is the same as saying I fit an integer number of half wavelengths into my transmission line. So this is what this condition here represents. So you do all that, and now you have this Hamiltonian, which is the same as for a harmonic oscillator, with q and phi conjugate variables. So again, they are analogous to position and momentum. And now for one particular value of k, you have one mode of the radiation in that resonator. That mode has a frequency of resonance which is k divided by c bar, where c bar is the speed of light in this transmission light, the transmission line, which is smaller than the speed of light, but in practice very close to it. The Hamiltonian for each mode is a harmonic oscillator like Hamiltonian, or you have an and dagger and so on. You have these energy levels. Now the most important thing is that if you think of the voltage, then the voltage becomes an operator. So the voltage in this transmission line becomes an operator, and it can be related to creation and annihilation operators for the electromagnetic field. And now what's interesting is to look at these prefactors here, and this is quite neat in superconducting circuits, because even though they look like relatively coarse and undefined things, you can in the end make everything. Connect everything to fundamental constants. And here, so what you have is, first of all, the electron charge divided by C tilde L. So C tilde L is the total capacitance of your transmission line from end to the end. Okay, so you can think about one electron spread out over the entire resonator. And then you have this other prefactor here, square root of N. This is proportional to the mode number. And then you have the ratio between these two impedances. And both of these impedances, actually, they contain fundamental constants. So RQ is the quantum impedance, is H divided by 2 is square. And Z naught is the vacuum impedance. So it's square root of L tilde divided by C tilde. So this, for a plane wave propagating in vacuum, this is just the square root of mu divided by epsilon. Here, again, it can be slightly different, but not very different. So you have this relatively neat way to write down how this voltage operator on the transmission line depends on creation and annihilation operators. So now, in circuit quantum electrodynamics, you're interested in coupling this resonator to an artificial atom. So you have this geometry shown here, where you take again the resonator I showed earlier, and here you have the charge qubit, which is in a slightly different configuration. So you have a so-called split Cooper pair box, where you have a loop, but the loop, the role of the loop is more of an auxiliary. So you can think, you can just think of this as being a charged qubit. So now it's possible to write down a Hamiltonian for the entire system, again using the same circuit laws and so on. But we take the approach here where we think of the voltage on this signal line here as being a quantum operator, and that voltage biases the charged qubit. So now, we look again at the charge qubit. So as I said earlier, if you are at this point where the gate charge, so the gate charge is this combination CG VB divided by 2E. So this is where states with 0 and 1 charges are degenerate to start with. So at that point, the energy eigenstates are given by these symmetric and anti-symmetric combinations of 0 and 1 Cooper pairs. And now, again, using a procedure shown in the previous lecture, you can take this Hamiltonian and linearize it around half a gate voltage, and you obtain this expression here. So the Hamiltonian, when you change the gate charge, which you do just by changing this voltage, so when you change the gate charge by a small amount, delta Ng, then you get a Hamiltonian which is proportional to the sigma x operator. And this is when expressed in the energy eigenbasis. Is this clear? Not too clear. Okay. So because this is maybe relatively important. So the idea here is that you have you have the two energy eigenstates, G and E. So this is E. This is G. So this Hamiltonian. The additional Hamiltonian, when you change the gate charge, has this expression here. So this is a constant, and this is an operator, the N number, right? So when you take these matrix elements, so when you take N between G and G, you get 0. Between E and E, you also get 0. And between G and between G and E and G, you get 1. So this is what shows you that operator can be expressed as sigma x in the energy eigenbasis. Mm-hmm. Does this make sense? Okay, so next, now the next thing is to consider this gate charge as being related to the quantum operator of voltage on the transmission line. And when you do that, you end up with the following interaction Hamiltonian between the charge qubit and the operator. So you have again a bunch of constants here, but the important term is this. It is Hamiltonian, where you have the product between sigma x, this is an operator related to the qubit, and then this combination, a dagger plus a, where these are operators related to the transmission line.
That
okay.
That is current, right? Or voltage.
That's voltage. So now, one next step which comes naturally is that if you take these two operators, maybe you've seen this before, the sigma plus and sigma minus, which either lower or increase the charge, then you can write this in the following way, and where actually you're dropping some terms which can be shown to be okay, again, related to the rotating wave approximation. And then you end up with this total Hamiltonian, which is h bar omega r a dagger a. So that's the photon Hamiltonian. This is the atom, and this is their interaction. And this is called the James Cummings Hamiltonian, and it appears actually in so many contexts, not only in quantum optics, in fact. Okay. Next. So now one consequence of that interaction Hamiltonian is that if you look at the interacting system, so say you take the states of the qubit, which are shown as spins here. So you take up and down, and then you take the states of the resonator. So when the qubit and the resonator are resonant to each other, you have these two states. So the qubit in the ground state, the resonator excited, and the qubit in the excited state, the resonator in the ground state, they are degenerate. But when you consider this interaction term here, g times a sigma plus a dagger sigma minus, these levels are repelled by an amount which is equal to 2g. And this is what is called the vacuum Rabi splitting. And when you observe this, it means that you have a clean circuit QED system, and the strength of the interaction is much larger than the decay times of the resonator and the qubit. And this was done for the superconducting qubit in 04, and this is simply a spectroscopic analysis of the transition between the ground state to this state and to that state, and you see two peaks which well, when interpreted properly, mean that you have the vacuum Rabi splitting. Okay, then another regime that is interesting is when actually the qubit and, so this is what I showed you previously. Now you can take the qubit and the resonator to be slightly detuned, which means that when you look again at the energy level diagram, you have these continuous lines. And now the coupling the coupling proportional to G between these two states will only have a small effect, which is second order in the limit where where G is much smaller than the detuning between the two systems. And now when you write down the energy levels for this, it looks as if when the qubit was in the ground state, the resonance frequency of the oscillator is omega R minus G squared divided by delta. And then when the qubit is in the excited state, the resonance frequency is omega r plus g squared divided by delta. So now it looks as if the resonator has a resonance frequency which depends on the state of the qubit. And this is important because it means you can use this as a measurement method for qubits. And actually this has been extremely popular, and it has a nice feature that it's qubit independent in a way. So as long as you can couple a qubit to a resonator with a proper coupling Hamiltonian, you can use this method to read out the state of a qubit. This is the experiment, so I'll skip this. One other use of this is the fact that now if you take two qubits coupled to a resonator, you have this Hamiltonian where again you have the resonator, then the two qubits, and then some interaction, the James Cumming interaction. And you can show that this type of coupling leads to an effective interaction between the two qubits, which has this form here. So you have a prefactor which depends on the coupling strength, then the detunings of the qubits, and then you have this sigma x1, sigma x2 term, which looks, if you remember now, for the phase qubit, we had a similar term, sigma y1, sigma y2, which could be used to implement quantum gates. And actually, you can do the same with this term. So now, this provides a way to couple two qubits, no matter how large the distance is in between them, which allows you to do interesting things again. And this has been used actually in a few experiments. And I wanted to show quickly this. So this is what probably you've seen this sample in the clean room. So we have we are working on an experiment where we want to couple four qubits by using this kind of architecture, where each qubit is coupled to the transmission line. Okay. So probably, this is very interesting, but I will just skip it for now. But the main point here, if you want to look it up later, is that when you look at the coupling between a real atom and the super and the resonator, the coupling depends on the power of the fine structure constant, which is 3/2. So the fine structure constant is a very small number. It's actually smaller than 1%. So now if you take instead the superconducting qubits coupled to the transmission line, this power becomes alpha to 1/2 or even alpha to minus 1/2, depending on how you couple the qubit. So you can see here, looking really at fundamental constants, how you can explain why superconducting qubits couple so much more strongly to the electromagnetic field in a resonator. And this improvement here can be a few orders of magnitude. And this is what makes things very, very interesting when you look at, you know, a new regime for Dirichlet's coming Hamiltonian.